Good morning and a very warm welcome to the 27th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. We have received apologies this morning from Maurice Golden, MSP. Our first item of business is a decision on taking agenda item in private. Can we take agenda item 3 in private?
Yes.
Thank you. Our next agenda item is an evidence session on the legislative consent memorandum for retained EU law, revocation and reform bill. And this morning we are joined by Julie Hesketh-Laird, Deputy CEO and Director of Strategy and Corporate Affairs at Food Standards Scotland, Donna Ferdice, Chief Executive of Seafood Scotland, Elspeth MacDonald, Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, Johnny Hall, Director of Policy, National Farmers Union Scotland, Sarah Miller, Chief Executive, Quality Meat Scotland, Ian Muirhead, Policy Manager, Agricultural Industries Confederation Scotland, and Dr. Gareth Hatley, Junior Vice President, Scottish Branch of the British Veterinary Association. And a warm welcome to all of you this morning. We have a round table this morning, which hopefully will open itself to some free-flowing discussion. But if I could have roughly an hour and a half with three themes, so we're hoping to maybe stick to the themes for half an hour or so. So our first one is the regulatory environment. And could I ask the witnesses if they could in turn give an overview of the impact assessment of the bill on regulatory environment in which they operate, including the potential impact on trade and the impact on relevant standards and protections in devolved areas. So if that's a brief starter for everyone, and if I could, I'll go around the room and turn it in. Ms Hesketh-Laird, if you could go first. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I work for Food Standards Scotland. We're the independent regulator for food and feed in Scotland, so we're independent of the government and report directly to you, I guess, in the Parliament. Our main concern about the bill is in relation to consumer protection. It allows for EU laws to be amended, and powers to do that, to be frank, would not necessarily be a bad thing, although some powers already exist. But it's unlikely that if it did, that we'd have been invited here today. It's the sunsetting approach for us that's hugely problematic. It carries huge risk and unintended consequences for consumers and trade. Retained EU law protects consumers and it enables trade, and the bill undermines our ability to keep consumer protection in place, and the risk to trade. Well, my colleagues who are trading here will probably talk about that today. There's absolutely no advantage in applying an arbitrary guideline, a guillotine, to food and feed law, irrespective of the date that that's fixed, whether it's 2023 or 2026. Huge effort will be required by my colleagues in the Scottish Government, in Food Standards Scotland, simply just to ensure that the existing standards that are there to protect consumers continue to apply after the proposed sunset date. So the critical purpose of food law is to prevent poor quality food and unsafe food reaching consumers. Regulation should restrict poor and unsafe practices because the purpose of it is to provide public protection. So deregulation that removes consumer protection is not an improvement. And this bill offers a huge opportunity for deregulation in a way that could really undermine consumer safety.
Thank you very much. If I could invite Ms Miller.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. So I'm here from Quality Meat Scotland. We are the red meat non-departmental public body from the Scottish red meat supply chain. And that's a supply chain worth about £2 billion and 50,000 jobs across the Scottish economy. And quite crucially, that economic activity is spread throughout both rural Scotland and urban Scotland. The key characteristics of our supply chain that could potentially be impacted by this in terms of the regulatory environment are that our supply chain infrastructure is spread across UK. So at primary producer level, the characteristics are that we have a lot of family farms supplying cattle, sheep and pigs into processors and other manufacturing sites. That manufacturing and processing side of the supply chain might involve retail packing sites south of the border, might involve retail packing sites and cutting plants over in Northern Ireland. So any friction in terms of divergence either with EU or within the UK could provide barriers to trade and, crucially at this moment in time, barriers to confidence in the supply chain, which is something that we're very, very conscious of, seeing the rising input costs across the supply chain. So I think for us, the key with this bill is to ensure that we do not allow regulatory divergence. We need that operating environment to be as cohesive as possible because of the structure of our supply chain, but we also need to ensure that it doesn't create any more confidence barriers to business when confidence levels across the supply chain are already as low as they are, dealing with some of the economic challenges right now.
Thank you. Dr. Hatley.
Yeah, good morning. I represent the British Veterinary Association, which represents vets who work in a whole range of sectors across the industry, from practice, and those are vets who are doing farm work or small animal work, but also who provide a reserve to government agencies in support of TB control, for example, or for exotic disease emergencies. Official veterinarians work closely with colleagues from Food Standards Scotland, and also within government. I mean, I'm now retired, but my previous role was within APHA in disease surveillance. We've heard quite a lot about divergence, and I'll add another, my penneth to that. The internal market's important because animal health and welfare is a devolved issue, as you know. One of the concerns is, for example, diverging welfare standards. So you could get to the situation, if this sort of thing plays out, where transport regulations one side of a border could be different from another, and that could have implications for how you move animals around. That's going to have direct implications on trade. So the internal market is hugely important, and divergence is a big issue. Likewise, in my world of disease surveillance, diseases don't regard boundaries, but if you have boundaries in place, you've got to minimise the divergence in order to maximise the control that you have of these diseases. Vets have small businesses, small medium businesses. Again, they are impacted directly by this sort of thing. I'll give you one example of one of the concerns from the regulatory perspective. Is EU law doesn't stand still. EU law is evolving. One example of that is veterinary medicines. The UK is considering... So one of the 570 regulations that's being considered by DEFRA, which fits in DEFRA's mould, is veterinary medicines regulations. That has huge implications. It's got resource implications, for example, for the BVA, if we need to provide consultation responses. We want to do that. We want to engage. But it's going to have, that's one of, there's another 569 to deal with from that perspective. So, yeah, large concerns about this. And I think there's going to be a clearer message coming from other colleagues who are going to give evidence that the sunset clause is an issue, and we would want it to be extended as long as possible, or kicked into touch if possible.
I wonder if I could seek clarity in just one thing you said there, Dr. Hatley, when you mentioned border. Did you mean the Northern Irish Protocol border, or did you mean
both,
different regulatory areas of the UK?
Both, really. Yes, yes, yes. It's contextually, it's relevant in both situations. Yes.
Okay, that's great. Thank you. Could I invite Mr. Muirhead?
Yep. Thank you very much, convener. So AIC represent the agri-supply trade in Scotland. So we cover sectors such as animal feed, fertilisers, crop protection products, grain trading, and also seed production as well. From our point of view, we would obviously be in agreement with many of the points that have already been made, and you will have noted from the written submissions there's a lot of consensus across our representative organisations. I think, just to rewind back slightly, I think the broader context here from a business perspective is that In general, regulatory uncertainty is not welcomed, and that's especially important in the current context when many of our members across the supply chain are experiencing real pressures in terms of inflationary costs, cost pressures for things like labour, fuel, electricity, and at the same time things like supply chain disruptions related to the war in Ukraine, which is obviously leading to a lot of market volatility. From our perspective, the existence of EU retained law was put in place obviously to provide maximum business continuity and certainty post-Brexit, which was at that time welcomed. Specifically, in relation to what is proposed, a good example would be if there was a failure due to the sort of sunsetting clauses and the timescales set out within the proposed legislation, if there was a failure to ensure minimum standards for food and feed safety, that would have major business and trade implications, particularly obviously for our feed producing members. And in a situation like that, what would probably happen is that the supply chain itself, through our various assurance schemes, would have to implement our own standards to essentially reciprocate EU legislation to ensure continuity of trade, especially where we have members who are exporting to the single market. And I think that's also, if we're looking at the wider context here, it also has risks associated with gaps in food and feed safety law, especially where there's a lack of an effective border operating model in place at the moment, especially for imports. So from a biosecurity point of view, for example, the risks from the importation of African swine fever, which would add increased pressure to our pig producers, who are already under immense pressure, would be, you know, a very negative consequence of those proposals. Having said all of that, I would also make the point that from our perspective, there are opportunities from the perspective of the ability to review EU legislation, and we can give sort of specific examples of opportunities within that, but that's caveated by the reality that we recognise that the mechanisms proposed and particularly the timescales proposed within this legislation are not realistic, and we recognise the time and resource pressures that would put upon all those involved. And the final point to make in terms of divergences, I guess, is obviously we have concern about that. Obviously, we have been supportive of the common frameworks and have given a detailed submission to this Parliament on the proposals that pertain to agriculture. And we would obviously continue to support that as the key way in which to ensure collaborative policy making across the UK to try and have retain some form of commonality in terms of regulation in some of these specific areas. So that concludes my comments.
Thank you very much. Ms Fordyce?
Hi, yes, thank you, Clerk. So Seafood Scotland is the trade marketing body for Scottish seafood. So we work with all of the industry to promote their products and try and get a premium price throughout the world. So whether that's in Scotland, UK, but mainly exports. So seafood is a highly exportable product. It's also a highly perishable exportable product. And we've seen when Brexit hit the severe impact that it actually had of us trying to get product into Europe. Now, Europe is the biggest export market for Scottish seafood. So whilst we export around £1 billion of Scottish seafood, 70% of that is going into Europe. So that is our main market. And previously, pre-Brexit, it was just like selling to Glasgow was like selling to France, you know, and that was a simple process that we've had. And it's been a real shock to the system for businesses to try and now operate under the Brexit model and cost, time, etc. And so there's a real fear as well that if the deregulation and you know, any standards that are lowered from our side, you know, I think would interrupt the trade again. I think there would be additional checks made at the borders, and that's just about to start happening in January with 5%. You know, if they cannot guarantee that we're at the same standards, you know, we could just envisage more and more checks, which would be more and more delays. The value of our product, you know, dwindles rapidly as it sits on a truck, you know, hour after hour, because even an hour means that you've missed the next day's trade, etc. So the impact of that with the companies is huge. The companies are also, as others have said around the table, really dealing with just such challenging markets at the moment. And I think we have to involve industry in all of the regulatory frameworks. You know, we have to listen to the voice of industry. It has to be workable for the industry. They have to be involved. And at the moment, they are so operational with such high costs of everything and labour issues and productivity issues. But, you know, it really has to be given the time that's needed to be able to make sure that they're all properly put into from EU law into Scottish law and into the UK law as well, taking into account obviously the UK internal markets as well. We've seen what's happened, and you know, we're feeling a bit of it when things are rushed. The Brexit deal was rushed at the end, you know, and so then all the fallout then starts to happen. Trade deals, we need trade deals, we get trade deals, and actually then it turns out actually these trade deals aren't the best for us. So that's a key thing as well. It has to be taking the time and making sure it's the right thing for us and not just to get something over the line and that it's done.
Thank you. Mr. Hall?
Thank you. I'm probably going to echo an awful lot of what's already been said, no surprise. I represent NFU Scotland, which is primary body representing agricultural interests in Scotland. As such, Scottish agriculture consists of about 17,500 individual businesses, employs directly about 65,000 people, and in turn provides the raw materials, if you like, for Scotland's food and drink sector, which employs around 365,000 people. Very closely aligned to the likes of Quality Meat Scotland and Food Standards Scotland and, of course, AIC Scotland, who've already spoken. So in some ways, Scottish agriculture is that linchpin in all these supply chains, both from the input point of view and in terms of providing the first link in the supply chain and ultimately to consumers of Scotland's food and drink here in Scotland and beyond. We have some significant concerns about this bill. We have done ever since it was introduced to the UK Parliament back in September, not least around the lack of clarity and certainty about the processes involved and the intentions involved. It's absolutely clear that regulation is required in order to underpin the integrity of what we all do in life. None of us particularly want regulation, but we all need regulation. No more so in agricultural production when you're talking about animal health and welfare issues, our responsibility around environmental management, and as businesses, there's a whole raft of business legislation, employment law, et cetera, et cetera. So the list is endless. And it's interesting to note that as a UK department, DEFRA is probably the department within the UK government with the most to deal with in terms of the potential implications of this bill. And so on. I think the most important point to, rather than repeat what has already been said, is that my concerns really revolve around the intersection of this bill and the existing UK Internal Market Act. And as numbers of folk have already said, how do we respect sort of devolved divergence of regulatory approach and policy needs to reflect the needs of food production and agriculture here in Scotland, for example, whilst maintaining, if you like, a relatively level playing field within the UK and the internal market. I retain, and we retain, some significant concerns around the UK Internal Market Act, particularly around those twin principles of non-discrimination and mutual recognition. And how that will play out going forward is going to be of huge interest, if not concern. And we obviously want to monitor that situation. Turning to the bill itself, I think certainly the conversations we've had with the UK government and UK government ministers around this is that it's very much a don't worry, everything will be okay. But I'm And we are not accepting of that sort of general assurance. We want to see something far more certain and committed in terms of how things will be dealt with. It's often been described to me that it'll be all a matter of, well, there'll be three buckets. We'll put some that we want to ditch into one bucket, some which we want to amend into another bucket, and we'll keep some others. Well, that's not really that smart at this stage in the whole process, in my opinion. And who's going to determine what goes into each bucket? So I'll probably draw a line there, but come back in with other comments in due course.
Yeah, thank you very much. And finally, Ms MacDonald, thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, which is made up of eight constituent fishermen's associations around Scotland. So we have members from the very north of Scotland to the very south and both east and west coasts. We have around 450 fishing vessels within membership, which is by no means all of Scotland's fishing vessels, but it does represent the majority of the catching effort in Scotland. And we have a very diverse membership, inshore, offshore, large boats, small boats, shellfish, pelagic fish, demersal fish. We've heard already some of the key statistics about Scotland's food industry, agri-food industry, and just in relation to fisheries, the value of Scotland's wild capture fisheries at first landing is around half a billion annually. And interestingly, about 60% of the total of UK landings, both in terms of tonnage and value, is generated from Scotland. So Scotland is the biggest part of the UK when it comes to commercial fisheries. I think I probably have a slightly different perspective on this than folk who have already spoken this morning. And I think because we've heard about public health, animal health, trade, but of course much of what I'm focused on and what my organisation is focused on is around management of fisheries, which is quite different in terms of what it's seeking to achieve and what its function is. And there isn't particularly a requirement for fisheries management to be harmonised. There are good reasons why you would want fisheries management to be quite different in different areas, for practical reasons, for biological reasons, for environmental reasons, for example. So, you know, a good example of that is the Common Fisheries Policy, which was a EU-wide policy for fisheries management. Much decried by those who were caught within it, because it was often very much too prescriptive, too rigid, and its regulations made much too far away from practical fisheries management. So the scope now for the to-be regulatory divergence exists. Fisheries has a very detailed and actually prescriptive chapter in the Trade and Cooperation Agreement itself that recognises that there will be divergence between the EU and the UK in fisheries management, and there's lots of provisions around that in terms of how it can be done. And we also now within the UK have the Fisheries Act, which again makes provision for and gives significant powers to this Parliament to develop the appropriate fisheries management regime for Scotland going forward. So there's a wish and a requirement for there to be a divergence from the EU in terms of fisheries management. But it's important that we get that right. And, for example, at the moment, the Scottish Government have been in consultation with the industry and with other stakeholders on something called the Future Catching Policy. And that is to replace a part of the Common Fisheries Policy around something called the landing obligation, which is completely unworkable and completely impractical. And what Scottish Government is trying to do is to work with stakeholders to find a practical, effective solution, an alternative to that, that is appropriate to Scotland's needs. But of course, to get that right will take time, thought, discussion, consultation, engagement. So there's very much something about taking the time to do this right. Where there is a need for and a sensible rationale for divergence, then we can have that divergence, but it's about getting it right and taking the time to get it right. And I guess the concerns of this bill are that there will be a rush in terms of the timescale in which sensible decisions may need to be taken.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to open to questions from the committee. If you do want to come in and comment, please try and catch my eye or the clerk's eye, and we'll try and ensure that everybody gets an opportunity to take part in the discussions. And I'm going to move to Ms. Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I start by thanking all the witnesses for the written evidence, because it's really powerful. And I want to open on the regulatory environment and the impact on standards and protections. Trade's been mentioned, and then the issue of regulatory divergence both within the EU and the UK. And I first of all wanted to get people to tease out the impact potentially on consumer protection and animal health, because I think just getting on the record is quite powerful. Donerford Dice, you talked about a cliff edge of the sunset clauses. And Food Standards Scotland, Julie Hesketh-Laird, you gave us some powerful evidence in writing about the impact on consumer health, and you gave raw milk and butcher shops example, and what the wholesale sunsetting of food law would do to completely remove consumer protection, but also animal health. I think it was also mentioned by Sarah Miller of QMS. There was a really powerful quote you gave there from the Food Standards Agency as well. And what struck me was it was both from the regulatory side in terms of protections, but also from the trade sector. And I think, Ian Muirhead, you gave a strong warning about impacting consumer protections. So could you just spell that out to have on the record what that means in terms of both public health and animal health, and if you have thoughts about how we'd prioritise preventing the potential impact of this legislation. So maybe Julie Hesketh-Laird, would you like to kick off?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Yeah, we estimate that there's probably about 200 pieces of retained EU law which we either lead on or we share with other parts of government. I think this bill seems to confuse red tape and consumer protection. The rules that are in place are part of a complex and very necessary legal system that sit in place to protect consumers and to enable trade. The scope of the legislation affected by the bill is massive. It covers basic food hygiene standards, public health-related import controls, requirements for the composition of animal feed. I could go on, you know, basic labelling requirements, some monitoring shellfish and so on. All of those things are absolutely necessary for the safety of people eating food in Scotland and outside of Scotland to the places that we export. The bill, we heard in Westminster in some of the debates there that the aim of the bill would be to take us back to the days when British laws were, you know, dominant. But actually, if you repeal or remove all of the laws that I've just referred to, in many, many cases, it takes us back to nothing. There is no protection pre-EU law. It takes us back to a day when those laws either did not exist, because lots of them have been superseded by EU law that's been put in place, and as many of the witnesses have mentioned, through, you know, proper process with risk assessments, have been properly thought through. They've taken their time to work through them, and they exist for a reason, not just to be red tape. So winding back to the days, you know, pre-EU law actually just in many, many cases removes all consumer protection. And then that in turn has a huge impact on the confidence I think our trading partners would have in the food that's exported from Scotland.
Thanks. Do other witnesses want to come in? I think, Donerford Dice, you talked about a cliff edge with losing the sunset clauses.
Yeah, it's just really, you know, with the companies then having their backs up against the wall, you know, of this, you know, how do we try and divert resources, you know, and probably a good example of that is actually at Elspeth at the moment in SFF with a lot of the consultations that's happening over marine spatial planning and the amount of time and effort and actually that takes from a business focusing on their strategy and the way forward, but actually having to deal with all of this and take time out of the business. So, you know, I think there's that, you know, real issue of how much time, if we rush it, you know, how much time are we asking of businesses? So it's really having that time to properly implement things that aren't going to be such a burden on the industry, because they will be so keen to be involved and ensure their voice is heard. So it's a workable regulatory environment and a sensible one. So we need to take into account, you know, just how much of an impact it will make on businesses if they're continually having to do consultations on a monthly basis, and just how that would impact their businesses.
And Ian Muirhead, you also warned about the impact of the bill on consumer protections. Do you want to say a bit about that in terms of both your concerns about public health, but also impact on the industry and animal health as well, and as it feed for animals as well? It was right across the spectrum.
Yep, so obviously from an AIC perspective, our main focus is on obviously livestock feeds, which are very important here in Scotland, where we are, you know, very much a livestock-centric agriculture. I think the main point I was trying to get across, and I would concur strongly with the points made by Food Standards Scotland there about, well, in reality, this is going to create an additional resource burden upon FSS at a time when there's a squeeze on available resources and staffing resources as well. And they obviously have a regulatory function within the feed industry in Scotland in terms of the delivery of official feed controls. So that's one side of the practicalities of this new work stream. But at the same time, because, as we've discussed, the arbitrary timescales and sunsetting clauses within this legislation, that would obviously create, from our point of view, an unnecessary and unacceptable risk of there being essentially a hole in legislation if it was not replaced, revoked, reformed with something similar. So that obviously is, you know, would then have a, you know, an impact upon the underpinning of animal health and welfare regulations. And as I've stated, if you take that into consideration from the point of view of a lack of a border operating mechanism as well, that creates even more risks from a biosecurity point of view. I would just pick up on the wider piece, which you touched upon about the regulatory divergence and the concerns as regards that. And obviously, I think the issue is essentially that this bill runs the risks of exacerbating divergences because of the timescales that are put in place, and because of the reality of how do you balance the executive freedoms of this place, of the United Kingdom government, maintain a level playing field when there are vastly differing political priorities from the point of view of, I assume, a view of retaining as much EU law as possible from a Scottish perspective and possibly going down a differentiated route in the rest of the UK. So that is, you know, that is a concern and maybe one to take back in terms of the timescales, which might make that divergence risk higher.
Thank you. And Sarah Miller?
And Mr Hall and Dr Hatley wanted to come in, if you could just let them in.
Sarah.
I
was hoping to bring Sarah
Miller in. Mm-hmm. With sheer range of legislative change, but you also highlighted food safety as well. I was wondering your comments on that.
Yeah, so I just want to dig in specifically on the animal health and welfare part, and I suppose to bring it to life and the reality within the supply chain. Because what we're talking about here is supply chain function, and because in red meat, you know, you're dealing with sentient beings, you're dealing with animals. If any part of that supply chain for any reason falls over, the impacts on animal health and welfare can be quite profound. In a way, our strength is also our weakness. So we have a strong red meat supply chain in Scotland because we maximise the environment and the resources available. We take sheep and cattle and pigs from, you know, the highlands of Scotland and you know, our less favoured areas, move them on to better ground for further finishing, and then we move them into other parts of the supply chain from there. So to maximise what we're able to do, we need to have that movement of both livestock and product, both across Scotland but also within the UK. One of the big concerns, going back to day one EU exit, was around the ability to export some of the animal byproducts that go into specialist markets in Europe and are then exported to third countries after that. And the consequence is something that sounded so insignificant, because there are no other routes for those byproducts, could have been that the processing sector would have had to have stopped processing animals until they'd managed to find a route for that. And the impact of that, you know, if you stop that one link in the supply chain, is that animals are potentially then in the wrong place. You know, if they're then not moving off some of the, you know, what I'll call the less favoured grounds where grass growth might be not be so strong, you then start to have potential welfare implications on farm. So that's why it's really critical for us as a supply chain to maintain that consistency in regulatory environment, but also the, you know, the supply chain needs its ability to function. And I think any kind of friction within that, you know, means businesses aren't confident, so they're not committing to, you know, either future trade or looking at new markets, or they're looking at, you know, they're de-risking parts of their business, which then doesn't help us because, again, we're quite a long-term supply chain, particularly in the cattle sector. So any knock to confidence now would also have ramifications for, you know, 3-4 years down the line. So they can be quite long-term impacts. And I'm trying to, you know, sort of bring this to life in terms of, you know, what happens at the business end, because I'm conscious that regulation and legislation can be quite technical, and I think it's important to reflect, you know, what would happen on the ground within that.
If we go to Mr. Hall first. Thanks.
Yeah, I just wanted to add something. Sarah Boyack's question quite rightly focused on issues around public health and animal health and welfare, but I would also add into the mix that we mustn't take our eye off this, is the whole issue about environmental protection as well, mm-hmm. which is clearly a significant of significant interest to agriculture. At the end of the day, agricultural land management occupies about 70% of Scotland's land area, and it's not just the land, it's the surface waters and all the habitats and environments within that landscape as well. And, you know, just to illustrate the point here, obviously a significant amount of agricultural support which came through the Common Agricultural Policy, which has now been rolled over into Scots law through the Agriculture EU Retained Law and Data Act 2020. So we've got a continuation of those schemes and the rules around those. And one of the key elements of that is something called cross-compliance, which talks about good agricultural environmental condition, but also includes something called statutory management requirements. And those statutory management requirements basically hang off an awful lot of EU law in terms of existing directives, particularly things like the Birds Directive, the Habitats Directive, the Water Framework Directive, and Nitrates Directive, and quite a few others as well. So it's complicated, it's difficult, but ultimately it filters down into what is expected in terms of basic standards of environmental stewardship. I think we need to be, as others have already said, we need to tread very, very, very carefully as to how we approach any sort of review, revision, and retention of those elements of what essentially underpins land management in Scotland. Because at the end of the day, we need to ensure that our environment is protected, and that is the bedrock of what we then do in terms of delivering on all sorts of other aspirations that we have, particularly coming from this place, around things like tackling climate change and enhancing biodiversity and all those things as well. So I'd urge that we mm-hmm. also consider the environmental components as well as the public health and the animal health and welfare issues. In fact, the list's pretty endless as well.
So I'm going to bring in Dr. Hatley, and then Ms. Hesketh-Laird wants to come in as well. So don't...
Yeah, thank you. And don't worry about the doctor bit. It's okay. It's just a grey style. I don't know how that slipped in, but it doesn't bother me. I mean, again, just to follow on from what Johnny was saying, it's Evolution Day, and biodiversity is very much in people's minds. I've got a background in climate change as well, so happy to sort of feed into that if that's relevant. But laying that aside for the moment, I just wanted to follow on from what Sarah was saying about supply chain issues. I mean, we've seen in across the UK issues with pigs, and I don't know if you remember the CO2 problem that we had earlier. If you have one thing that goes wrong, particularly in a carefully controlled supply chain, pigs back up, and when pigs back up, you start getting animal health and welfare issues. So if we have anything that adds to the pressure on the supply chain, you pretty quickly start to get serious problems in terms of animal health and welfare. So it was just another example of that. The other thing I wanted to point out is that, you know, whatever our views about Brexit, we're now post-Brexit. One of the consequences of that is that we are now no longer in the club. And from an animal disease surveillance perspective, that has implications for the, if you like, the level of confidence that the EU, our major trading partner, has in terms of what we do in terms of control of endemic disease, exotic disease, and the bar has gone up. And it's just to reflect that that's, you know, that has a consequence in the way we, you know, the way we respond to that. Also, in terms of our response to exotic disease surveillance, I'll give an example of blue tongue disease. You may remember in 2006 we had blue tongue. We don't particularly want it again. If we did get blue tongue, it's really important that it's coming to this divergence thing and cross-border, that we, across the piece, we deal with the disease in a collective way. Because if we start imposing movement restrictions on animals that respect the, if you like, a country's boundary, for example, that could have implications about, for example, where the abattoirs are. So we need to work in because this whole thing is so interlinked and is so complex that if you start tinkering with one bit, I think what I'm saying is it's almost like the law of unintended consequences. So we need to be cognizant, we need to have time to consider what the implications of, you know, making a change are going to be. So it was really just to give some illustrations around that.
Thank you. And Ms. Hesketh-Laird.
Thank you. I just wanted to go back to your direct question to me, actually, was about the consequences of, you know, some of the really difficult things that we're going to have to tackle on the regulatory side of things, and some of the examples that were in our written evidence. I just wanted to touch on those, just to bring to life the complexity of food law. Food law is a system. There's not lots of neat little bits of legislation that we can just, you know, put in a bucket to keep or save. They're all really deeply interlinked and intertwined, and they go back for many, many years. And the example that we put in our written evidence on E. coli kind of brings that to life. And I just want to go through the example because I think it is a really powerful one. Back in 2004, old prescriptive sector guidance was replaced with a risk-based general requirement for most businesses to come in line with a hazard analysis principle of food hygiene and food safety. It was negotiated in Europe, and the main aim for the UK at the time was to achieve effective, proportionate and risk-based controls. The precise example that this really helped was where raw meat that is contaminated, potentially, say, with E. coli or something similar, but let's take the E. coli example. If it comes into contact with ready-to-eat food, the consumers of the ready-to-eat food can become really seriously ill. Now, that happened in 1996. It's a well-known case in Lanarkshire where there was a fatal cross-contamination incident with E. coli, with 490 cases of E. coli and 18 associated deaths. That led to the Pennington report, the Pennington Group report, which, among other things, you know, recommended a licensing scheme for butchers, which applied pending their training and the rolling out of the hazard-based approach. That European scheme then came in and replaced all of the UK kind of interim protocols. And that was, you know, came into place when the EU rules came in 2006. So rolling us back to a time, you know, pre-EU rules, you know, takes us back to no consumer protection in that area. I mean, the evidence is stark there that, you know, we would assume that, you know, if the bill goes through in Westminster, that measures would be taken to preserve those basic requirements. But it seems really strange to us that you would want to sweep away, you know, vast tranches of European law that are there for a really good reason, and then have to build them up from the start, go through the, you know, the argumentation, take up Food Standards Scotland and Scottish Government time to rewrite rules, you know, in a slightly different but similar way to the EU ones, to put the same process back into place. It's not a good use of my time, my team's time, the Scottish Government time and parliamentary time. I'm sure there are places that we can make we can speed processes up or make amendments to regulations that would improve things, but this is absolutely not the way to do it. The time and the resource and the effort that would be taken, I think Ian Muir had mentioned that, you know, at a time when the civil service is pushed, you know, greatly for resource and people, there is no good time to do this, but now would be the worst.
Can I bring in Ms. Mintel, please?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to explore what Julie Heskes-Laird has just talked about. And I think, Donna, you touched on it as well in your evidence about how businesses had to change and, as a result, what didn't happen because you were having to look at the new ways of doing things and, I suppose, what in Food Standards Scotland, what you wouldn't be able to do if you're having to spend the time on this. Donna?
Yeah, so... You know, the impact, obviously, when Brexit happened and, you know, and it came to actually a halt for, you know, for a couple of weeks because the system broke down that was in place and so they couldn't do it. But the impact was, even just before Brexit, you know, so for 2 years before Brexit was implemented, the amount of working groups, the amount of committees that people were responding to, you know, it was a real, real focus for the business leadership teams who were continually at meetings on a weekly basis, trying to prepare for Brexit. So then when Brexit happened, and it wasn't a case of that's Brexit, this is it, you know, we're here. It then has to be implementing all of that. So definitely the focus has been huge. And the impact of it as well, you know, that consequential impact is that we don't have enough staff. So whilst we're out there promoting the fantastic products that Scotland has to offer, the reality is we can't process it because we don't have enough staff. So last year, last Christmas, the retailers were delighted to only get 70% of the product lines that they would usually get because they were worried there would be less. You know, companies are contracting. They cannot take up any of the opportunities. Well, a lot of the opportunities that are out there, or they're swapping out rather than being able to grow. You know, it's a massive issue that is had. But the time and resource of just operationally trying to prepare for Brexit and then actually dealing with the fallout. And it's still happening. You know, it's just continuing. So sampling's about to start. Commodity codes issues last week as well. So we couldn't get products over because there was an issue with commodity codes, etc. So it is just continual, because things change constantly. The EU changes things and we're not told about it, so then you try to find out, you know, how that impacts us. And so it just takes a lot of time. We've had to bring in Brexit specialists to actually be there and help support companies, and they're still there. They're still helping companies and supporting them to get through a lot of the regulations that have changed in a post-Brexit landscape. So, you know, it's costing money to have these specialists help support, and you know, it's still taking the time. So I just think that whole consultation process, going through it all, everybody wants it to be right, and to be able to do that, it takes a lot of time and, you know, and a lot of resource. And especially during this time, and you know, Sarah and a number of us have touched on it, you know, it's unprecedented times is what we've heard, you know, from all of the companies during this, you know, is a crisis, not helped by the Ukraine situation, etc. But it really is really unprecedented times. So it's you know, it's worrying that the amount of time that the companies, if it's rushed, would have to put into it. Whereas if it's spread over a longer time, it could be managed more sensibly. Mm-hmm.
Julie Heskes-Laird.
Just to pick up on Donna's final point, we'd be nervous too, actually. It's that rush. It's that, you know, would there be any inadvertent, unintended consequences of not getting this right, I think, would be a real challenge if we were working through all those sort of 200 pieces of retained EU law. For us, when Brexit happened, it meant that we had it has driven huge change within, you know, Food Standards Scotland and the regulatory environment. We're now having to, I suppose, replicate some of the work that the European Food Safety Authority did when we were in the club. We've now had to create teams in Scotland and, to be fair, to the FSA in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. They've had to replicate that too, so we work really closely with them. But there are people in my organisation doing work that was previously done through a much bigger organisation with much better resource. That's already difficult for us to resource. We're already having conversations with the Scottish Government and ministers around how we can provide that service going forward. The resource review from the Scottish Government that came out earlier on in the year, back in May, I think, has indicated that we're going to have a flat budget for the next 5 years. So that's already difficult for us to, you know, begin to take these things forward. I can't answer the question right now as to what wouldn't we do.
It's a bit crystal ball, isn't it?
I mean, there's so many regulations, we don't know what buckets they're going to end up in, even if I say you could even put them in buckets. But we are working through a process at the moment, and I can't preempt this board paper going to Food Standards Scotland on the 7th of December that begins to unpick for us, if we had to shift resources off things, what would those things be? But I don't think it would be any secret if I said now that things like, you know, managing incidents and food crime and inspecting meat plants are all absolutely top priorities. And, you know, we would really find it difficult to take any resource off those things at all. But there's, you know, lots of other work where we'd need to divert whole teams, you know, of people onto our EUL. And I think probably I wouldn't be exaggerating if I said if we put our whole team onto this, you know, sort of single bill, it probably wouldn't touch the edges of what we needed to do. So that would be difficult conversations, I guess, with the Scottish Government as to how much they would want to resource this going forward, because that decision sits with ministers and not us.
Thank you.
Other contributions? Can I bring in Ms. McDonald first?
Yes. Wanted to perhaps illustrate some of this from the perspective of a trade organisation. I think Julie and Johnny have both spoken about putting things in buckets, and it's not as simple as that, because you can't just look at one regulation and say that one goes in keep bucket, that one goes in ditch bucket, that one goes in we'll think about it bucket, because as I'm sure will be the case in all the commodity areas, certainly in fisheries, what we have already been doing is, of course, drilling through every piece of EU law and saying that particular clause could go, that particular clause might still be useful if amended. So it's, you know, it's a huge task in terms of, say, it's not a keep then straightforward exercise. It's much more, you know, line by line, what pieces are no longer relevant, what pieces would you want to get rid of, what pieces would you change, what pieces would you keep. So it's a huge task. I think thinking about the perspective of, you know, what we wouldn't do if this task were to be accelerated, I think it's more a question of what also government wouldn't be able to do, because we are aware, certainly in fisheries, that there are many. There's an ambitious programme of domestic policy and domestic legislation on fisheries. Some of that comes from the Bute House Agreement. Some of it comes from the Future Fisheries Management Strategy that the government published a year or so ago, setting out its vision for Scottish fisheries for the next decade or so. And there's much to do in all of that. And government resources will be stretched to do a very extensive programme of regulatory reform, as well as the domestic policy development. But when you then translate that onto a relatively small trade organisation like ourselves, and you think about the resource implications of that, you know, it's very significant. And, you know, we are already under very significant pressure from things like the expansion of offshore wind in Scottish waters and the implications for fisheries. So there's a great deal to think about in terms of how resources could be best deployed to the appropriate priorities. And I say, I think it's will impact both upon government and on industry bodies.
Okay, I've got three indications from our visitors, and then I'm going to move to a question from Mr. Cameron. So if you could try and be succinct, as we are sort of running over on this area already. If you could bring in Sarah Miller, followed by Gareth Hatley.
Yeah, I just wanted to pick up on actually the question that went to Donna as well about the impact of EU exit really on the business environment. And for us, you know, that Glasgow-Paris analogy is absolutely perfect. You used to be able to put a pallet on a lorry and it could drop off in Glasgow, go to Paris, and it was the same regulatory regime. So it was easy for businesses to access high value markets, and the level of risk to that business in terms of diverging away from core business perhaps into domestic retail markets was low. What we've now seen is added risk put into export. So whilst businesses now have found a way to do it, it has added additional risk. So their appetite for export, we have seen, has definitely reduced, although I would say that is starting to come back. And I guess from my point of view, having sort of been through the roller coaster that was EU exit in January 2021, we're now in a better place now. My fear would be that if we start to increase that risk burden again, you know, that is significant economic opportunity that we are losing for Scotland. Trade in terms of to EU exit was down 36% in Q1 2021. It took us a whole year to get back, and there's still some businesses who were previously exporting who are not. So I think that for me is the key thing to remember in all this. It's economic activity that it's stifling.
Gareth Hatley?
Yeah, quickly from me, just to follow on from what Julie's said, and pointing back to Sarah Boyack's original question about public health and animal health, I just want to contextualise that a bit and say, you know, from a veterinary perspective, we're really talking about one health here. It's in the round. It's not. There's a lot of interactions. So, for example, in my world of disease surveillance, probably between two-thirds and three-quarters, something of that sort of order, of new and emerging diseases have what we call a zoonotic potential. That means a disease that can pass from animals to man. We've had an example of E. coli 0157 that's clear. I'm just pointing out that the law of unintended consequences means that something will probably happen, and we need to make sure that the regulatory environment doesn't stifle our ability to detect disease earlier. The last point I'd like to make is that again, going on to what Julie was saying about resource, don't forget that in 2001, and I remember it well because I was there, it was an abattoir vet who first detected foot and mouth. So if you're taking resource away from those areas, you put other areas at risk.
Thank you. And Mr. Hall.
Yeah, very quickly, just to echo the commentary of Julie and Elspeth, and then the point that Gareth's just made as well about the timing of this, first of all, and the political urgency to be seen to be doing something at a time when we probably need it least in terms of that review process, and then probably coming to a conclusion, actually, we still need an awful lot of this to continue. It serves a purpose. It serves a very important function. And that then takes you into the questions around resource and capacity. Right now, Scottish Government is consulting on a new agriculture bill, which will come into the Scottish Parliament in 2023, along with other pieces of legislation. And that in itself is a huge task for Scottish Government officials. It's the first time Scottish Government has had to really do this, given that for decades, it was basically about adapting the Common Agricultural Policy to Scotland's circumstances and working within those rules and those objectives. This is very, very different, and it's already stretching the capacity of Scottish Government officials. And if they were to be taken off that, plus the ongoing processes around existing schemes, their inspection, their compliance issues, the monitoring, all the APHA work, etc., etc., it's just not feasible. It is absolutely unfeasible. So at some point, to use a cliche, the wheels will come off if we do that. And I think that would be extremely dangerous for all sorts of interests.
Thank you. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And I should refer to my register of interest in agriculture within that. I'd like to return to the questions of staff and timing and resources in the sort of third section. Can I ask about two issues? Firstly, about deregulation. The bill itself gives the both the UK government and the Scottish government the ability to restate EU law, retained EU law, and replace it in its entirety. And I should, I don't speak for the UK government, but I think it is only fair to put their position on deregulation. They have consistently said that they do not want lower standards, and in fact have said in some instances they want higher standards. Would the panel accept that whilst there is plainly a risk of deregulation, there is equally the potential to either mirror EU standards or indeed enhance protections, and that ability applies to the UK government, perhaps more pertinently to the Scottish government in terms of what they can do? And I think, Julie, could I propose that question to you, seeing as you mentioned deregulation?
Well, I suppose, yes, the bill could give the opportunity to do it, but why use valuable time and resource to go through that process when we have very strong rules that are put in place and have been negotiated based on evidence, risk assessed, there have been proper impact assessments done, there's been consultation, there's been due legislative process taken place. Why would we sweep all of that aside and start again and have to unpick, as Elspeth says, you know, the food law is not it's not neat buckets, it's a system. It just seems odd to want at any time to unpick a whole system, to rebuild something almost entirely identical from scratch. It just does not seem like a good way of spending taxpayers' money.
Arguably, the bill would simply allow the Scottish Government just to flip whatever retained EU law exists into a new form of law, you know, without any of that.
Well, yes, I suppose it does, but I suppose we're not confident that through the process of the bill that everything that we would want to be retained will be retained. And why not start with the premise that you retain everything rather than sweep away everything? You know, that to me is the wrong way around.
Could I move on to my second point? And I think this is principally directed to Elspeth and Johnny, which is around divergence. I think today, Elspeth, you spoke about the stakeholders you represent and please correct me if I'm wrong, but actually a wish to move away from EU law that perhaps enshrines a common fisheries policy. And Johnny, in previous evidence of this committee, you've also spoke about the common agricultural policy and the needs and sort of moving away from that in terms of the needs of Scotland's farmers and crofters. It is, of course, Scottish Government policy to align with EU law. And I suppose my question is, looking at this bill, do you have any observations on the policy behind this bill in allowing your sectors to move away from existing EU law? Elspeth, perhaps you could
start. As I said in my first remarks, there's a recognition between the UK and the EU that there will be divergence on fisheries management, and that's reflected in the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. We also now have the UK Fisheries Act, which again creates a framework for secondary legislation across the UK in a devolved context on fisheries management. So I am not a lawyer, but I would think that there is already that provision to start that divergence of fisheries management regulation from the common fisheries policy. I'm not sure how much this bill adds or detracts from that. That would need some sort of careful legal analysis, but I think there is an existing framework there. I think, as I said, there is certainly much scope to develop better fisheries management measures that are more appropriate to Scotland, that are not EU-wide ones that you're then trying to fit into your Scottish circumstances. Johnny is absolutely right in his comments. He said we may not always like regulation, but it's important to have it. We have to make sure that our fisheries are being managed appropriately. And I think the way that the Fisheries Act is set up, again, recognises that there will be different ways in which you might want to do that, even across the UK. And there's provision there for a really quite an innovative approach of using fisheries management plans to determine the right types of fisheries management for different fisheries in different areas. So I think our industry certainly welcomes that opportunity for divergence in terms of how we do fisheries management. But we also recognise that much of our product is exported, and it is important that consumers, both at home and wherever our export markets are, have confidence in the product. So we recognise that the points that others are making. So I think, yes, there's definitely scope to do things better in fisheries management terms from the EU law. I think we've already got a pretty hefty body of legislation in the UK to allow us to do that through the Fisheries Act, which I think this Parliament gave its legislative consent for. So I say I don't have as yet a clear understanding of what this bill sort of will perhaps add or subtract from that.
Johnny.
Yes, could I first of all go back to your first point? And I agree that there is the potential to, if you like, do things better, I think you said. But I don't think that potential can ever be realised if we're looking at a sunset clause, or, as I prefer to call it, a guillotine, 13 months down the track. So that's the problem. I agree that, you know, if time's on your side and resources are on your side, then there is an opportunity through this to look at things and improve, if that's the conclusion. But I don't think the time pressures that the UK government are trying to put onto this, arguably to shake up certain government departments to get them to do this sooner rather than later, I don't think that helps at all, as we've previously discussed. In terms of aligning with EU policy, there's always that little caveat at the end of that, aligning with EU policy where practical. And that's been stated by Scottish Government on a number of occasions. I think in terms of the common agricultural policy, as you've heard me say before, it doesn't work particularly well in Scotland's interests. It doesn't work for Scottish agriculture particularly well, and all the responsibilities Scottish agriculture carries around food, climate, biodiversity, rural development and so on. So the opportunity to diverge or move away from the common agricultural policy, I think, is a very important opportunity for Scotland to take. But the overriding objectives in terms of those things I've just mentioned, high quality food production, climate, biodiversity, wider rural development issues, they're not diverging from Europe's own objectives. It's just that there's an opportunity to shape and do things in a way far better suited to Scotland's profile and needs. And it was always a bad fit, the common agricultural policy for Scotland. And it was clunky and it was difficult and it made it far more challenging. So I think there is an opportunity to still deliver the same intended outcomes as Europe is trying to achieve on a number of things, but to do it in a much more bespoke way for Scotland's needs.
Thanks.
Donifer Dyson and Ian Muirhead want to come in. So, Donna, could you go first?
Yeah, thanks. I just want to pick up on the enhanced protections, actually. And I think we have to be careful as well that we're just not gold-plating some of the regulations, because we want to have more enhancement. Now, it may be for food security, consumer protection, that we may want to do that, but we have to make sure we're not creating more red tape for businesses, you know, that we're not given an additional burden in Scotland that wouldn't be applied across the UK, putting us at a disadvantage, you know, just because we're maybe gold-plating more of the regulations as far as trade's concerned, we won't get a premium for it. So it's not as if we enhance things, we'll get more money for it. We'll still get the same money for the goods that we were doing, you know, but again, there may be areas of weakness that we feel that we want to enhance, but it's making sure we don't do additional burden on the business and for no additional benefit, and really just being put at a disadvantage.
Okay, Mr. Muirhead.
Yep, thanks very much, Convener. I just wanted to pick up on a couple of points, and I think it was a really good question to bring up, Donald, as regards the proposals. I think from our perspective, as I had stated in our sort of opening remarks, we do welcome the opportunity to review existing EU legislation, notwithstanding our concerns about you know, obviously the proposals as they stand. And it would be interesting, I guess, to understand a bit more about what you referred to as the flipping process for retained EU law and how that would, you know, in terms of the resources that would be required to do that and the timescales for that. But if we're talking about what we could do with the existing resources, well, probably a more targeted approach to review of EU law. So, you know, we've got a number of specific examples where we can see real benefits that would be accrued from specific targeted approaches. So I'll give you two examples. One is, at the moment, there is an issue with a differentiation between the GM approvals process within Scotland and the United Kingdom and between the EU. And that has been exacerbated by, obviously, the war in Ukraine and supply chain disruptions, meaning that our members have had to source commodities from other places out with Europe. And therefore, because they are trans-shipped through the European Union, it creates a real issue where there is a differentiation between what is approved within the EU and what is approved within the UK. And therefore, there's a real pressing need to have a reformed review system within Scotland and the UK for that. And that's an example of where FSS resources could be deployed but may not be because of proposals within this. And another example, for example, would be the retained EU law around feed additive authorisations. And there's an opportunity there to look at bringing in additives which can help with methane mitigation within livestock, which would have real environmental benefits for both the Scottish and UK livestock industry and help to meet emissions reductions targets. But because of some of the specific barriers within the retained EU law, that's quite a difficult thing to do at the moment. So that's just two examples of where there are opportunities within the process. But I think just to finish there, I think in reality, when it comes back to the issues around EU alignment and the UK approach, really, the UK frameworks and the common frameworks approach only really works if there is that political commitment, which I understand was contained within the common frameworks, to work in a consensus and to reach compromise where possible, to have that, you know, degree of commonality across the UK. So thank you very much.
And a very small final point from Ms McDonald.
Yes, thank you. Johnny articulated very clearly how you can have similar objectives but different ways to achieve them. And I just wanted to put on record all that I think is what the Fisheries Act aims to achieve. It says there are a number of overarching objectives that the Fisheries Act is there to achieve, but recognising that there are different ways of how you get there from the current model of EU law. And just on that point, from Mr Cameron about Scottish Government's approach to divergence, I think what we are seeing in fisheries management is that they are willing to look at divergence from EU law. I think we see that through the consultation and the work to develop a new catching policy for Scotland. And it's not about increasing or decreasing standards. It's about trying to achieve the same overall objectives, but having a more practical and a more fit-for-purpose way of doing it for Scotland, a more Scottish determined policy and legislative way to do that. The devil will be in the detail, of course, and I think that's why important that these things are given sufficient time and focus to make sure that we get them right and we don't end up with just a sort of slightly different set of laws but still ones that don't work particularly well.
Okay. I know Ms Hesketh-Laird wants to come back in, but if you could pick up your point in answering questions from the committee. I'm going to move to a question from Dr. Allen.
Thank you, convener. Julie Hesketh-Laird mentioned, I think you said, that the situation around the reserved EU law bill was strange, I think was her word. And I can assure you that many of us here find the idea of 4,000 or so laws in a one-hour pretty mystifying as well. But the area I want to open up is more around how those laws might be replaced and probably looked at, how cumbersome a process that might be. But one of the issues that our committee has been considering is also the idea that UK ministers might amend laws in devolved areas, would have the power in many areas to devolved to amend laws in devolved areas. Now, NFUS has raised issues around the kind of restrictions that UKIMA UK Internal Market Act would place on Scotland's agency to act. I wonder, can people say, open up a discussion about what people feel about what it implies for parliamentary oversight, for the involvement of interested parties, if it's UK ministers that are potentially amending laws in devolved areas?
First, I don't have a strong answer to that because I sit outside of government, not in government, and those are issues really for the government to opine on, I suppose. But I guess I just go back to my previous comments around, you know, scrutiny at the place where the rules are applied by the people to whom they apply, from the experts in the jurisdiction where they will apply, I think is really important. So, yeah, there's the obvious constitutional issue. And just to touch on the previous point there about deregulation, I would agree with Ian Muirhead, actually, that there are some areas that we could improve. And, you know, regulated products for feed is one of those areas. I think we could genuinely speed up the system by just removing some of the clunkiness and the process that happens, whether, you know, you'd get your authorisation for methane enhancers, I don't know, because it would still need to go through the same kind of scrutiny, which, you know, as Alistair Allen's implying, is really, really important that it's done. And I think it's important that in Scotland that's done by, you know, people who govern Scotland for the benefit of consumers in Scotland.
Yeah, if I may just come in there as well.
If you look at the bill in a very simplistic way, and that's kind of what I do with most things in life, the intention is basically by the 31st of December 2023 to wipe off the statute books, and if I can use that sort of language, existing EU law or retained EU law, unless you either provide an extension or you exclude it from that process, in very, very simple terms. But my reading of the bill is that the issues around extension in particular are within the gift of UK ministers because it is a UK bill. But nevertheless, there are clear, as Dr. Allen has expressed, issues around what is a reserve matter and what is a devolved matter. And that's where we get into this very complex and political arena. And I think that's going to make it even more difficult, if that's the easier way to put it. From our point of view, and I guess maybe from others around the table here today, it's the practicalities and the pragmatism around some of those issues that is really going to matter. And as I said earlier in response to another question, it's about who's going to decide what sort of process are we actually going to go through to say, actually, yeah, this piece of law is removed, or we extend it, or we exclude it. And that, I think, is the cause for concern, because at every point I've asked UK government or UK government departments, getting that clarification has been extremely difficult. In fact, there is no clarification.
Miller?
I just want to do, I think one phrase really brings this together, and it's that unintended consequences, because I think there is something in there when you're changing so much legislation and that regulatory environment so quickly, you do miss some of those sort of consequential links that will then impact our environment, our businesses here in Scotland. And I think that is the danger that we're in terms of slipping into. How you fix that, you know, is the question mark, because, you know, we know that following EU exit we have to reform that regulatory background, and that has to be done, but it's the timescale that has been, you know, it's an arbitrary timescale that we have put in place. We don't need to do this to ourselves. We could do this in a much more phased approach that would lessen the impact on business, but would also, you know, we spoke earlier about the common agricultural policy, you know, would also enable us to build some of these key foundational pieces that we need post-EU exit, to, again, to go back to what I was speaking about earlier, to make sure we can capitalise on the economic opportunities we have in Scotland. There's no point in reframing that regulatory environment if it's just going to cause additional cost on businesses, which then, in terms of Scotland, could mean that we lose economic activity here to other parts of the UK, which is then detrimental to jobs, it's detrimental to the environment, it's detrimental to us. So I think, you know, it's that unintended consequences we need to be very, very aware of.
Okay. Ms McDonald.
Thank you. When the Fisheries Bill was going through the UK Parliament, and as I say, this Parliament gave its legislative consent for that bill, which I think was probably one of the only Brexit bills to which this Parliament gave consent. One of the reasons that we were broadly supportive of that bill, and indeed of that Act, is because it is a framework and it doesn't prescribe a great deal of detail at that primary level. What it does is it gives quite significant wide-ranging powers and responsibilities to the Scottish Government and to Scottish ministers to make legislation in Scotland. And as I say, one of our biggest criticisms of the Common Fisheries Policy was that it was made too far away from those who were both knowledgeable about the areas that were being regulated and also impacted by it. So I think, as a principle, it would seem that if UK ministers are making changes in devolved areas, then that should be with the consent of Scottish ministers who are closest to these areas. And I think if change starts to happen in that sort of uncoordinated way that I think Sarah has just described, then the risk of real sort of confusion and unintended consequences is very large. So I think there's a real lack of clarity about how all of these different moving parts are going to work together to ensure that we have a sensible functioning statute book for our various areas of responsibility. So I think there's a lot of unanswered questions, but I think there's a lot of scope for confusion and unintended consequences that we have to be careful to avoid.
Thank you. Dr. Allen, did you want to come back
in? No, I'm content. Just let others come in as they wish.
Ms. Boyack, did you want to come in from this area? Ms. Mintel? I think we've strayed into covering our three themes in some of the areas that we were earlier on. I wonder if I could just ask a question about the Scottish Government's levelling up. Oh, sorry, Mr. Ruskell. Yeah. My apologies.
Thank
Mark.
You. Yeah. Yes, I should just declare an interest in relation to British Veterinary Association. I'm an associate member, although not a doctor. I wonder if I could just sort of pick up actually on that third theme, Convener, which is about practical considerations. And I think we've covered some of that already in the answers. But just drilling down then into the next 13 months, because it is only 13 months to that guillotine, as it's been described, that cut-off point. Can I get some reflection on what this actually means for your organisations and how you anticipate working directly with government departments, particularly DEFRA, who are having to review, you know, 570 laws? I mean, we've had some sort of general concerns about resources, staff implications, but how are you actually practically trying to work with that challenge in terms of engaging with your members, engaging with government departments, setting up working groups? I mean, what does that stakeholder engagement look like for you? Because these decisions are very real if that sunset timescale remains at 13 months rather than a phased approach or a much longer deadline. So, yes, Gareth.
Yeah, if I could just come in there. I mean the BVA is a member organisation. As a consequence, it's responsible to its members. It's got those members provide the funding for this sort of thing. BVA engages at both devolved level and at UK level, but it's got limited resource. And so, if the simple answer to your question is that if a lot of effort has to go to reviewing retained EU law, those resources can't be spent on other things that are important to do with both animal health and welfare and also, you know, human health and welfare. And by that I mean the health of vets. So it's just I can't give you an exact figure, but it will have a profound impact.
Yeah, yeah. So that was a useful reflection on impact. I'm interested also in practically what measures you're putting in place, because the clock's really ticking on this. So, Donna, did you want to come in?
Yeah, I was just going to come in and say, at the moment, I don't have any engagement with DEFRA on any of this. But just reflecting on what we did with the Brexit was really pushed by industry. You know, DEFRA, you know, they held continually meetings with industry, trying to, you know, really do their best. I mean, they did step up to the plate for, you know, after post-Brexit came in, you know, of trying to get it all resolved, but they don't have the manpower. So again, it's talking about, you know, the resource issue. They change constantly in DEFRA as well. You know, there's, you know, the people change. So then it's an education again. It just seems to be continual of that education piece with staff within DEFRA as well, unfortunately. But it is, they don't have the resource. And to have 570 pieces of legislation, everything else will be set aside. And it's a bit like what Julie said, is what do you focus on? You know, what is going to be the key parts? Because we've still got a lot of other issues to be dealing with. And so to have that volume would be a real struggle. And so I think they would be really struggling to engage with industry and see all of that as well. And I think they might end up with a bit of frustration. And just, you know, we've not come across that yet. But I do think that, you know, there was a lot of effort and time put into to Brexit. And, you know, they will step up. But I just think that it will overwhelm them. And if we give them such tight timeframes, you know, it will... You know, won't be what we want.
So I'm getting the sense that there isn't a plan. No one's given you a plan to say, right, well, these are the dates where you need to respond. Sarah, do you want to come in?
Yeah, just on that one, you know, this for us is meant developing a whole new work stream. You know, QMS, part of our core role is to market, you know, run consumer marketing campaigns, Scotch beef, Scotch lamb and specially selected pork. But because of the challenges that this bill could potentially bring in and actually getting product to market, we are having to invest more time and levy payers' money in ensuring that we have the bits of pieces of legislation in place that enable us to trade, which then, you know, at an ever-decreasing pot, it means we've got less money to spend on that core marketing work, which is a very, very, you know, stark choice that we're having to make to keep the wheels on. And we do have a limited resource at QMS, but even bigger than that, I'm going to use an example on another piece of legislation that's going through the parliaments at the moment in the welfare of animals during transport. So that was a UK government manifesto commitment. What we found during that process is that the stakeholder engagement was very, very disjointed, particularly when it came to the devolved nations. We came in late. We weren't even invited to some of the discussions that really impacted our sector. We had to push to, you know, I constantly feel like I'm having to remind people that we exist in Scotland. And I think that's really important. I think we need to make sure that the inert challenges that Scotland faces are reflected as stakeholder engagement takes place for each of the different provisions that will be reviewed in terms of that legislation. But that is a huge amount of work. You know, just for one bill, it's taken up a considerable amount of our time. But it's important because of, like I say, how product and animals move within the UK. So we can't not do it, but it's what it then means, you know, we can't do.
Okay.
Me wanting to come in as well, Mark. Can I come back to you?
In response to your question about what engagement is there, as yet specifically around the implications of this bill, I think really none, either with the Scottish Government or with the relevant parts of DEFRA. Obviously, it's touched upon in terms of this is here and it's going to be a big deal, but there has not yet been as yet any detailed specific discussion with either government about how and when to do things. As I think I've alluded to earlier, there is already some emerging domestic policy in some of these areas anyway, certainly in Scotland, but that had started previously and was not in response to the introduction of this bill. I think the what was published yesterday actually was a joint fishery statement, which was a joint statement across the UK with the four fishery policy administrations setting out how they intend to achieve the objectives of the Fisheries Act. And I think, again, that shows a good cross-UK relationship in terms of how the administrations work on fisheries. They do work quite well together, although they'll have different ways of achieving things. But we do recognise that we know that in Scotland, Marine Scotland is under very significant resource pressures. They've got huge commitments from the expansion of offshore wind that are also putting enormous resource pressures on my organisation, and also from things like the commitment to introduce a huge swathe of highly protected marine areas by 2026. So there's going to be a real clash of domestic policy ambition with achieving what this bill sets out to do. And as I say, at this stage, there has been no specific discussion about the implications of this bill with either government.
Mr. Hall?
Just to add, we've been in London for the past couple of days, and in those couple of days, we've met with ministers from DEFRA, ministers from Scotland Office, and ministers from DIT. And I guess it wasn't so much about committing our resources to that, because we just haven't got the resource to do that, as others have already expressed. But it was about seeking that clarification piece, that transparency and that openness about what's happening, and also being able to then, for want of a better expression, be some sort of sense check, as I think other organisations could be, around some of the potential implications, the unintended consequences that we've already touched upon. And I think that's going to be really, really important. But whether we get the opportunity to do that or not in that time frame remains to be seen. In terms of the UK context, obviously we are NFU Scotland, but we work very closely with our colleagues NFU England and Wales, and also the Ulster Farmers Union in Northern Ireland. And collectively, we're all in the same place on this, so we'll be sort of working very closely together to try and bring to bear our influence on the processes in Westminster. Having said all, called out DEFRA, Scotland Office and DIT, my understanding is that the lead department on all this is BEIS, and getting some inroads into BEIS is proving quite difficult at the moment.
Okay. If there's time for another question, I was going to seek clarity just on your preferred sunset clause, if you prefer a sunset clause at all. And I think, Gareth, you'd said you want to see the laws in place for as long as possible. Johnny, I think NFUS, you'd said 2026, which itself, we've had evidence to suggest that's quite an arbitrary date, because 10 years since Brexit. But I'm just wondering if you've got any specific thoughts when a sunset clause, if any sunset clause, should be implemented, or if this phased approach is the best way forward, and it's hard to kind of pick an actual date.
Firstly, I'll ask the question, if I may, and we can provide a written response on the current plans within BVA to answer the need. I think if I may reflect on what other witnesses are saying, and they may wish to come back on this, is that a lot of this, you could almost call it a business uncertainty, because we don't know, we're unsighted, just because of the sheer volume of stuff, what the consequences are going to be, and so it's very difficult to plan at this stage. I can give an indication of where our planning has got to, but just to reflect that within DEFRA itself, about 80% relates to EU law, and about 80% is devolved. So it tells you instantly there's a lot of legislation to get through. So that just gives the frame that it's a big ask, and therefore the length of time, I think, will depend partly on the priority that both UK government and the devolved administrations also put to particular issues. And until we have some dialogue and sight on that, it makes it very difficult to then put resource into an issue that may relate to our particular sector. So I think it's the uncertainty of it, really, that's preventing us to answering that more detailed.
Yeah, just to add to that, I think it would be very dangerous to put any kind of deadline on this, because we've already shown we don't know what's coming round the corner. COVID came and disrupted absolutely everything, and particularly that preparation for EU exit. So I think with the current uncertainty in that wider kind of geopolitical landscape, we want to make sure we get this right rather than rushing into something with the level of unintended consequence.
I think everybody's views have probably been aired, so unless anyone's got anything more to add on that, I'm going to have a question from Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Kavina. I've got two questions, and they're basically variations on Mark's questions, which is, I think, the date that once he speculated in the media, if there is to be an extension, is 2026. I just wondered, you know, that's 4 years from now. Standing what's just been said, is that date, would most people be in favour of that date? Albeit I accept there are some people who don't want any date or don't, you know, have fundamental issues with the bill itself. But that's my first question. My second question is engagement with the Scottish Government. Elspeth spoke a little bit about this, but has there been any contact engagement with the Scottish Government, given that Scottish Government under this bill has the ability to restate retained EU law, and obviously there are devolved competencies involved. So I'm just interested if, understanding the Scottish Government's policy to align with EU law, wondering if there's been any engagement with the Scottish Government and or its agencies. Don't know if anyone wants to come back on that.
Bring in Jordan.
Very quickly, Donald, certainly at an official level, I've had some initial discussions with Scottish Government on this, and probably shared some concerns around, to go back to your first question, around the implications of a that sunset clause and the possibility of an extension in some respects. But I do feel that dates are kind of arbitrary and they become something of a hostage to fortune, a bit like government targets, really. But yeah, so in terms of engagement with Scottish Government, that is underway, and I think it will be critical.
Bring in Julie, and then Elspeth. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Like Johnny, we don't support a sunset clause at all. It's arbitrary, and how do you choose 23, 26, 29, 30? I'd rather start from the beginning, and you know, work through good rules than have arbitrary guillotines over perfectly good rules that already exist. In terms of engagement with the Scottish Government, we're a non-ministerial department, so we work quite closely with the government. We are talking to them all the time about these issues. They're setting up some internal governance, and we're beginning now to get involved in some of their work. We have our legal advisers working with their legal advisers, looking at the raft of legislation that could be impacted, affected, or you know, sunsetted by this bill. We are involved in their governance arrangements. We're taking a paper to our board next week to consider how we advise the government on which bills should fit in which buckets and which one is the most difficult to unpick. The decisions on which ones they go with sit with the government. They're for ministers to decide, but our advice will be based on some principles that we're beginning to now develop as to, you know, how would we help them choose the right ones to keep or sunset. So consumer protection obviously is one of the core tenets of that paper that we'll be taking to our board next week. We're also in touch very closely with the Food Standards Agency, because of course they're in the same boat as us on all of this. They'll be talking to their government departments down south, but like us, they're in the same position, already running very fast to manage some of the implications of EU exit that we're still, you know, having to catch up with and replicate systems from the EU. So like us, they're really short of resource to manage this. We've a number of people internally looking at this at FSS, but nowhere near the kinds of capacity that I would like us to have. If we were to need more resource, we'd have to have a difficult conversation with ministers as to could they fund us, you know, better to do this work, or actually, if not, what would they like us to drop and stop doing in future if we wanted to work this through to whatever arbitrary deadline the bill picks.
Mr. Muirhead. Seda, did you want back in as well?
Yep, thanks, Convener. I think we would concur with everybody's view that the idea of an arbitrary deadline would be very suboptimal, to put it politely. And I think I'd just go back to our opening comments about the context that we find ourselves in. We as a trade association are under a lot of resource pressure, and our members are under a lot of pressure because of the past few years have been really difficult when you think about COVID, ongoing EU exit issues, and now what I'd term the cost of production crisis for our members and everybody throughout the supply chain. So industry is dealing with a lot at the moment, and added business uncertainty and increased resources required in this area wouldn't be welcomed. And as I've said previously, I think we want to look at a more sort of I don't want to use the word ad hoc process, but review of EU retained legislation on an ongoing basis and try and prioritise what needs to be looked at first by industry and take that approach. And I think realistically, just going back to the question that Mark posed about stakeholder engagement, I think it's pretty obvious that it's not possible to have meaningful stakeholder engagement with the current 13-month deadline. Many of us have been involved with the Agriculture Bill consultation and the previous iterations of that, and that's been stakeholder engagement over at least a 4-year period, which gives you a bit of a sort of context on that one. So,
okay. Elspeth, and then I'll bring Sarah in for a final question. Thanks.
Yeah, I think dates are arbitrary, and I think what's more important is careful policy analysis and working out the priorities in terms of where we want and need to change. And certainly within our organisation, we've been doing some of that. We've been doing it for some time before the introduction of this bill, in terms of needing to see what parts of the EU body of fisheries management law that we would like to see changed. I think what we need to see from government is that commitment to move away from this common fisheries policy and to see that continue. I didn't want to give the impression that we hadn't had any discussion with government about these issues. We've spoken with both DEFRA and UK government, other parts of UK government, such as Scotland Office, and also with Scottish Government, about the fact that this bill is now making its way through Parliament and there will be implications of it. But what we haven't done is have detailed discussions yet in terms of what that entails. I would echo the point that Johnny Hall made about bays. I think I sometimes pick up a frustration in other parts of UK government that maybe there needs to be more joined up government thinking around the consequences of these bills, and I think it's really important that there's greater engagement with BEIS in terms of the implications of this and the scope for there being unintended consequences if this isn't done right. Thank you.
Sarah.
Thanks, Convener. Reading your evidence and listening to you today, clearly 2023 is a massive cliff edge. 2026 is still a cliff edge because it's not that long off. What do witnesses think about taking the opposite approach, which I think one of you mentioned, which was instead of dumping everything, then you actually think, what do we keep everything and then decide what you want to get rid of in terms of flexibility? And that would be a much more prioritised, much less risky approach, which would give you the opportunity to seek opportunities rather than take the risk of putting environmental, human health or animal health at risk and the huge uncertainty.
Julie has already expressed that. Does anyone else want
that.
To?
We would support that.
Unanimously around the room, everyone supports that. Reversal of the position, maybe not.
I think we would just have to be mindful of sort of not getting sort of into inertia, and then sort of domestic policies in other areas are sort of taking effort away from ever actually from giving this the attention that it needs. As I say, there's good reasons, certainly in my area, from why we need that divergence, but we have to make sure that we get it right, and it's more important to get it right than get it fast. So it has to be done properly, but we just need to, I think, be mindful of the fact that if you sort of push these things into the long grass, then other things come along and get in the way. So I would just make that caveat.
I think that's a very important caveat, and just reflecting on the evidence about the sheer scale of the number of pieces of legislation to review, it would let stakeholders and advisers actually prioritise where you want to take the opportunity, rather than the panic that's clearly going to be in place very shortly for people. Thank you.
So I'm looking for further committee members if they want to come in. I think everyone's exhausted their questions this morning. Can I thank everyone again? It's been a really interesting, really engaging session this morning, and I echo the thanks for all the written contributions that you gave for the evidence prior to today's meeting. We'll now move into private session of the committee. Thank you.